This storm has caused confusion and delay.
You have caused
confusion and delay.
I think you are facing prejudice.
Daisy is just the ultimate thought. Daisy is just the ultimate thought.
Your impatience has caused confusion and delay. This storm has caused confusion and delay. You are causing confusion and delay. You caused confusion and delay.
26 years old and you can't even drive? I can. Are you stupid, eh? Are you a stupid fool? Well, why can't you drive then? You can't even drive! Bit grey today.
Well, hello everyone and welcome to another Deepest Lore. We are gathered once again for, don't call it a part four, our fourth standalone show on Francis Bacon. And I believe we're going to be into the 70s, flares and all today. Is that right, Alexander Adams?
Yeah.
Yes. I was overruled. I wanted the title for this standalone fourth film, completely unrelated to the others. I wanted the title to be following the naming conventions, Suede and Corduroy, the Bacon in the 70s.
Did he wear flares?
Oh, he certainly did.
Excellent. All right. Full length
black leather jacket. Oh. Speaking
of the 70s, the news has hit us that Uncured, Who Is It For, have just released a massive expose on the Tony Blair Institute and mainstream kind of normie conservative Twitter is ablaze today with people saying, oh, look how outgunned we are. Look at the Tony Blair Institute. And that has led me to declare that the Dark Lord Watch is a toothless old woman. I thought that was a kind of neat tie into our old Bowie streams. You got a, I'm going to be like Thin White Duke era AA now. Dark Lord Watch was Diamond Dogs or whatever. So,
yeah. You know.
Thin White Agent.
Thin White, or not so thin White Agent.
Fat Brown Agent.
Less of the brown. Anyway, let's carry on. How about just perpetually have a migraine, Agent? If I'm quiet today, it's because I'm sitting with a kind of sponge or pillow or something on my head. And so I'll kind of be in the background. But I'll just remind people, do pick up courses at the Academic Agency. Alexander Adams, anything you would like to shill?
Yes, I'm happy to promote my Linktree, which gives links to all the stuff that I do. If you want to help out and you want to get yourself some great stuff, you can always buy my book, Blood, Soil, Paint, from Imperium Press. You can also buy my lino cuts of artists. Those are original artist prints. Those are also available through the merchandise page of Imperial. And also on the link tree is my Ko-fi. So if you just want to give a small donation, you can do that. You can also go to Substack and become a paid subscriber. That helps me very much.
And Dee, anything you'd like to show?
No. I mean, you can follow me on Twitter and you can certainly tune into Unpopular Opinions tomorrow. If you want to hear me mute my mic when you talk about things that I don't care about, but nothing
the,
special.
The entirety of the
the entirety of the show is
this is always terrible. Mr. D sounds such a gentleman after I've been a terrible merchant. So he's so distanced.
Oh, I can merch it with the best of them, but I'm just laying low for the moment. Yeah.
Okay, great. So shall we start with this video, Dee, before we get back to the works?
Dee? Sorry. Okay. I'm trying to figure out my cursor disappeared. No, I've got it back. I think we should start it just to get us, you know, back in the mood to hear the cadence of Mr. Bacon's voice. This particular little extract is from the end of David Sylvester's, was it 1966, that film?
I can't believe it. I'm having to do a live on air for Zoomers. Flares are trousers they wore, or pants if you're American, in the 70s, which had very, they kind of went out at the ankle or down at the bottom. They kind of flare outwards. So they had very big trouser legs. If that makes any sense. Like what and they the used to wear in the 70s.
The 70s was a period in the past. The past being the time before now.
The time before the iPhone.
Exactly.
All right, let's carry on.
All right.
Man realizes that he is an accident and his futility, that he's a completely, really futile being, that he has to play out the game without reason. I think that even when Velázquez was painting, even when Rembrandt was painting, in a peculiar way, they were still, whatever their attitude to life was, they were still slightly conditioned by certain types of religious possibilities, which man now, you could say, has been completely cancelled out for him. Now, of course, man can only attempt to make something very, very positive by trying to beguile himself for a time, by the way he behaves, by prolonging possibly his life, by buying a kind of immortality through the doctors. You see, painting has now become, or all art has now become, completely a game by which man distracts himself. What is fascinating, actually, is that it's going to become much more difficult for the artist because he must really deepen the game to be any good at all and return the onlooker to life more violently.
Are we there?
Can you? Yeah, is my screen empty? I'm trying to.
Yeah, well, now I see a picture. I see the next slide.
You can see it. Yeah, it was meant to come up seamlessly, but it didn't work.
Okay. I thought I lost you. Do you want to? I mean, I will say about that film is it's one of the very few films or videos of Bacon actually working in his studio. Now, how genuine it was, I don't know. He may have just been sort of pretending to paint. But as far as I know, there are really no other films of him actually in process. Although, of course, it cuts just before he approaches the canvas. But I think just from that standpoint, I think it's very interesting. Do we have anything to say about what he said?
Yeah, well, on the idea of people... There is supposedly only one photograph of Bacon painting, and that's by Barry Jewell, who we've mentioned previously, who was a Canadian man who acted as a handyman for Bacon in the 70s and 80s. So I think what happens is when people want you to do press, because as an artist, you get asked to take, you know, they ask to have photographs of you. And so what they usually do is they get you standing next to a finished picture and you just hold a paintbrush in your hand and look thoughtful. So that's often the way it goes.
Yeah, exactly. I have actually been, I've been put in that situation and I've always refused. They want to, I mean, I think it's of course hilarious in the case of Bacon, because his studio was, so monstrous that it's almost a kind of thumb in the nose him picking a tube of paint out of that giant mound of detritus and squeezing it on a plate. I think that was quite apt. As to the sort of substance of his statement, his sort of existential nihilism aside, I do think it's interesting because it's what he said was sort of an analog of the kind of conversations that we often have in these spaces, which, again, what is the purpose of art? How does art remain vital, you know. I mean, what is the sort of animating spirit of the art of an age, you know? And he said, of course, that religion, you know, in a structured way, was at least a vestigial part of the work of you know, artists of the past, and of course a very important part of some artists' work. But you know, what in the modern age, what does it become other than a sort of pastime, you know, other than a sort of folly? And of course, he, you know, in his sort of charismatic or his sort of typical manner, he chooses to frame it as violence, you know, that you almost must commit an act of metaphorical violence through your work to kind of not going in the Brechtian sort of, you know, agitprop thing where you've got to shock them out of their false consciousness. I don't think that is what he was saying at all, but you know, sort of a very interesting kind of take of finding you know, sort of the animating spirit of creation in a materialist gaze.
In a couple of weeks, or I can't remember, it was like 2 or 3 weeks, the event is taking place this year, and the topic is something like overcoming entropy, or like how do you deal with entropy, basically. And you could say that Bacon's response is one of the possible responses, which is basically coming to terms with the fact, well, you're not going to go back to the, you know, when God was alive, to use the Nietzschean, to reverse the Nietzschean phrase, right? So in this moment, how do you confront the kind of the nihilism of the age? And in a strange way, he's basically just saying, like, I'm going to figure it out by going through it, by just basically saying, this is what it is, and I'm just going to face the void full on type thing. Do you think that's true?
Yeah, I think so. And I think he wanted to explore the human, it's a horrible cliche that was used at the time, the human condition through desire, and also through poetic means, by evoking other things, by, you know, trying to correlate aspects of modern life with echoes of classical statuary or past art that was great, you know, so something like Rembrandt or so on, and to try and find analogies between the accidental everyday forms that bodies and places take, and trying to link that to art, and sort of not so much ennoble, but kind of examine what it was to be human through the links between the quotidian and the artistic.
Indeed, I certainly agree. But you know, and of course, again, you know, there's this idea that you cannot sort of find the mechanism to do that. You cannot find your armor. You cannot find your weapons to face the horrors of the present and the dread of the future, but by necessarily going to the past, you know, it may not work. Now, you could certainly be guided, of course, as we all are. I mean, that's what we call, you know, history. That's what we call culture. That's what we call cultural patrimony. But you know, you've got to sort of find a way to do it, a new way to do it. And you know, I think a lot of people just make a false assumption that, you know, we can return to these forms, you know, from the past, and that's how we'll do it. But again, you cannot inhabit those forms. I mean, as Bacon said, you know, I mean, he in retrospect thought it was an absolute mistake to engage with that Velázquez portrait of Innocent X. You know, he thought it was just complete folly, because there was nothing he could do or say about that picture that wasn't contained within itself as one of the great artworks of the world. You know, you can't go back and inhabit another time, because it just doesn't work. You'll always be in a costume, you know.
There's also a rather difficult concept that I've come across before, which I kind of agree with and kind of don't. I mean, it really depends on who people have in mind. But I have seen it being said that even religious people today, most religious people, like they say, like, let's pretend they're filling out their form and they say they're a Christian on the form type thing, right? Viewed from, like, from the point of view of, say, I don't know, the 11th century or something, those people are functionally atheist. Do you understand what I mean? Is like, if you drop those people into one of those previous eras, the other people in the church there would think of that person as being like functionally atheist.
Yeah, because the modern Christian so often is thinking in terms of rational things. They're taking scientific terms. They don't they don't pray twice a day. They don't go to church. You know.
Yeah, and there's also other kind of trappings of modernity. And you actually the venue where you'll see it most redolently, I would say, is when they stage these, in my opinion, rather pointless debates between, let's say, oh, the Christian versus the pagan, right? And in those debates, I very often see the Christian basically regress into almost like a Fedora Reddit tier type science, like, because they scoff at beliefs that are straightforwardly supernatural, right?
Yeah.
In a way that their 12th century counterpart or 11th century counterpart may have not done.
This is especially a problem with all flavors of Protestantism, which have sort of, again, which sort of, you know, to strip sort of ritual, you know, that it became a sort of, whether it's all metaphor or not, you know, and I think that is a problem, because of course if you take all of that out, if you take all the vital spirit, you know, the idea of a muscular Christianity, the sort of Christianity that could, you know, that could cause men to, you know, to ride off to, you know, to the Holy Land and in battle for the church, you know, when that all goes away and you're sat around talking about, you know, structural racism and the sanctity of immigrants, you certainly have lost it. And I think that's what, to an extent, that's what Nietzsche was referring to, you know, this sort of bourgeois domestication of the Christian spirit, where it just becomes about social convention and loses all of its
polite
fire of the spirit.
It's polite and civilizational, and the magic, the kind of the violent magic of it has gone.
And the fear of hell.
I'm not just picking on Christians, by the way. You could pick like modern secular Jews, or indeed those kind of types who hang out with Sadiq Khan, you know, like my moderate Muslim friend type thing, and the same is basically true of them as well, to greater or lesser degree. So yeah,
well, this is the curse of rationalism, you know. It not only decays and deteriorates, you know, religion, but it does it to all human mystery. I mean, certainly art, and the creation of art, the artistic spirit, I regard as also another area which is, of course, laden with, you know, magical forces, laden with the connection to the supernatural, connection to the spiritual, an ecstatic experience, And, you know, it's of course seeking to even, you know, and it has certainly succeeded in mostly deteriorating that as well, you know, just bringing everything into this, you know, the world of the rational and banishing the world of the spirit. And I don't think it survives. I just don't think anything can survive once it has been hollowed out in that way. So I think that the two quests, you know, to revive the fire and to revive the mystery, they're certainly related in both art and religion.
I mean, I don't want to be on too much of a downer, but do you remember there was that whole period where I was taking a AAA to the Church of England? Throughout that whole period, when they did communion, even though COVID was long gone, they were still all wearing the masks. And you had to do like socially distanced mask wearing. And the whole sight of it was just kind of, you couldn't look at it without being reminded of the entire kind of scientific managerial state apparatus around the religious ceremony. There was just no getting away from it. And in fact,
the worst part. Yeah, yes. And I think the point of it, I think part of the point of it was to show that now, of course, it's not going to affect, you know, the right of certain demographics to protest, because, of course, that's sacrosanct. But God forbid you're going to go to your church and participate in your transcendent rituals. With either we're going to stop you from doing that, which they did in some places, or we're going to make it so. I mean, you remember that horrible image of the I don't know what he was, priest, using a water pistol, like it was like a joke, like he was baptizing like an infant with a water pistol, you know, to stay socially distant. You know, I mean, if that is how you regard, I mean, you might as well give up. If that's what you can do to your faith, which is a deadly serious business, then just give it up, take off the vestments, and go home, because you'll just play acting. And that was one of the most infuriating parts of the whole COVID thing, and of course how thoroughly and readily most churches just gave into it and accepted it.
All right, so what are we looking at here? What is this? Where are we in the Bacon journey? As I understand, we were getting towards the end of the 60s last time.
Yes, so this is from 68, I think.
67.
67, yeah. Okay, would you like to introduce it? Oh, yeah, so this is Triptych 1967.
Yeah.
So this is an interesting subtitle, Mr. D.
Yeah. So I actually learned that it isn't actually the subtitle. That subtitle has just been sort of appended onto it. But in fact, Bacon inscribed on the back that it's just called Triptych 1967. But so the subtitle is that is often associated with this is inspired by T.S. Eliot's poem Sweeney Agonistes. Now, I don't know if you know that particular work. It's not actually a poem. It's a fragment of a drama in verse that Eliot started to write in, I can't remember, in the 1920s, and never finished. It's a sort of fragment. It's about 16 pages. But it is a very interesting work, and there's some really extraordinary things about it. It of course is staged occasionally. It's sort of done as a one-act play now, and there are proper characters, including a character called Sweeney. Eliot, if you know Eliot's poetry, he also wrote several poems, Sweeney Amongst the Nightingales, with this kind of character of Sweeney, and this particular. This particular, call it poem for all intents and purposes, but has a number of characters. Sweeney, it has a prostitute called Doris. It's got two American businessmen called Mr. Klipstein and Mr. Crumpacker. And it's got a soldier called Sam Watchoke. And another figure called Captain Horsefall. So it's got, you know, a very sort of knowingly satirical kind of tone. It's also weirdly kind of written in a sort of jazz era syncopated language. And if you'd like, I can read a couple of little extracts from it.
Please go ahead.
Yeah, so it's also subtitled called, it's called Fragments of an Aristophanic Melodrama. And there's a prologue, called Fragment of a Prologue, and then There's a second part where Sweeney actually appears, called Fragment of an Aegon. So let me I'll just read a bit from that. Sweeney comes in and he's speaking to Doris, the prostitute. She says, "You'll be the cannibal." And Sweeney says, "You'll be the missionary. You'll be my little seven stone missionary. I'll gobble you up. I'll be the cannibal." Doris says, "You'll carry me off to a cannibal isle?" Sweeney says, "I'll be the cannibal." Doris says, "I'll be the missionary. I'll convert you." Sweeney, "I'll convert you into a stew, a nice little white little missionary stew." Doris says, "You wouldn't eat me?" Sweeney says, "Yes, I'd eat you in a nice little white little soft little tender little juicy little right little missionary stew. You see this egg? You see this egg? Well, that's life on a crocodile isle. There's no telephones. There's no gramophones. There's no motor cars. No two-seaters. No six-seaters. No Citroën. No Rolls-Royce. Nothing to eat but the fruit as it grows. Nothing to see but the palm trees one way and the sea the other way. Nothing to hear but the sound of the surf. Nothing at all but three things." Doris says, "What things?" Sweeney, "Birth and copulation and death. That's all, that's all, that's all, that's all. Birth, copulation, and death." Doris, "I'd be bored." Sweeney, "You'd be bored. Birth and copulation and death." Doris, "I'd be bored." Sweeney, "You'd be bored. Birth and copulation and death. That's all the facts when you come to brass tacks. Birth and copulation and death. I've been born, and once is enough. You don't remember, but I remember. Once is enough." So that sort of gives you a flavor of the way this work is written.
Hell of a rhythm. Did they ever make a musical of it? Should be a musical.
Very peculiar thing. Yeah, yeah. So, and of course, depending on which production, I mean, if you've ever seen a production of this, it is sometimes sort of done to a very deliberate musical rhythm, very deliberate beat. And there's extraordinary things in this. And basically, there is sort of a story in which at a certain point, Sweeney may actually murder Doris. But then, of course, there's a whole point where, you know, there's this whole thing where he talks about he knew a man who once did a girl in. Any man might do a girl in. Any man has to, needs to, wants to, once in a lifetime, do a girl in. Well, he kept her there in a bath with a gallon of Lysol in a bath. You know, and so he tells this whole story about a friend of his who had murdered a woman and kept the body in disinfectant. And then there's a whole section where, of course, Sweeney says, "I don't know, I may be dead, you may be dead. Doris, you may not be here. I may not be here." And so it's sort of playing with these weird, rude interactions in a room of a very odd nature. And of course, Eliot is also bringing in and sort of layering on top of this the idea. I mean, you know, why call it an Aristophanic melodrama? Why this evocation of an Aegon? Why this evocation of, you know, of Aeschylus? So it's a very curious piece of writing. And of course, that Eliot has invoked it here. Now, of course, we know from previous streams that Eliot has always maintained and declared that he had no stories to tell. He was never telling a story, that he was never giving us a narrative. So what do we see, and how do we relate this picture to some of those things we heard?
I think you meant Bacon. You said...
Eliot Bacon, yeah.
Yeah, I will also say that Eliot, specifically Eliot's choice to write verse drama in itself was somewhat self-conscious in the early 20th century. It's one of two. I mean, there was a little spate of doing it in the 19th century too with Shelley and you know, Prometheus and Bound and all those sorts of things. But then there was kind of a little reverse drama revival with Elliot as well. So just worth knowing, because I think that was as against the, what did we call it last time? The social realism, which was also a force moving through English drama at that period as well, as well as art. So,
yeah. And also you had the poets of the 30s who were sort of expressly political, but Elliot was largely... He was political in his cultural commentary, but his poetry was largely free of overt politics. There was lots of implied politics.
Yes, he does have one really good book which I recommend everybody read called "Notes Towards a Definition of Culture." That's the one kind of non-fiction Elliot book that I recommend people who are in this for the politics to read. Anyway, let's get back to Bacon. Yeah.
So this picture also, I mean, this is one of my favorite Bacon paintings. I will state, as far as I'm aware, that this is the most colorful Francis Bacon picture.
Pretty
I mean,
much,
it has the most sort of broad use of various families of color and various color relationships. It's also very, very strangely structured. I mean, we see, of course, some of the familiar elements that that we've come to know from Bacon and Bacon's work as it developed in the 1960s. But it's also really odd, and he really never produced a picture or set of pictures like this again. This sort of very a center panel that almost suggests a kind of looking out of the room. You know, we're almost always trapped in a kind of space, in that kind of room, the room with the curvature, or the room within a room. And with all three of these, of course, we're given a sort of glimpse of distance. You know, we're given glimpse of distance in the left panel, and in the center panel, almost the kind of hint of horizon, even though it's just a window shade pulled down. And then in the third, of course, a figure emerges from another room, from another space. So it's to me, it's just quite unusual in the Bacon corpus.
And also you get like a nice touch of detail. You rarely get this in Bacon, but there's a chest of drawers in the background with a bottle and a glass, and you rarely get that amount of realistic detail in Bacon.
Yeah. And there's of course the fag ends and the packet of cigarettes in the foreground there that we often see. But you know, of course, I mean, you read Eliot's verse drama. Which, you know, is amongst other things, this extraordinarily kind of reductive triptych of life, you know, birth, copulation, death, that's repeated again and again. It comes down to brass tacks. That's the facts. The facts of life are these three things. And of course, you're also given in Bacon a triptych, a three panels, a trilogy. So are we meant to sort of think of these as birth, copulation, and death, these three panels? What are the relationship between the figures? You know, are they, you know, are they copulate? Are they, what is the man that, you know, that sort of enters the room? Has he killed them? You know, what has happened in the center panel? You know, and again, it's so much of these kind of works, and this way that Bacon proceeded with his work in the 1960s, that these sort of intimations of scenarios, intimations of sort of relationships, but without ever sort of like tying it up to a specific narrative.
Yeah, and also what you get is you've got this sort of strange armature, so you've got like the curved mirror, but of course, and the mirror is only sort of, it is partially reflecting the figures, but then it's also reflecting other things as well. And I think that sort of people have talked about shop displays. So the sort of shop displays that you'd find, the advanced shop displays you'd find in Soho, because Soho was sort of, you know, very fashionable, and it would get the first plate glass, it would get the first sort of very large mirrors and so forth. And also it was a place for sex shows. So there is, you know, there's the hint of the sex show about this.
Yeah, that almost this is a rotating turntable, you know, with these figures. But, you know, I mean, but then, of course, you get, you know, you start that sort of, the logic of that falls apart. Because, of course, in the third panel, where is that figure? I mean, if they're lying before a mirror and, you know, you see this sort of suggestion that foot in the foreground is mirrored, where is he? He's only in the mirror. He's a man. A man in the mirror, to avoid that reference again. And also, he appears to be on the telephone. You know, if people remember the old telephone receivers with the wire. You know, so there's all sorts of curious things that this trip brings up. And as I said, it's one of my favorites.
Yes, one of mine.
Shall we move on to the next one? I quite like this one as well, for what it's worth. So, okay.
You wanna have a go at this one?
Yes. So this is what lying figure with hypodermic syringe from what's it? This one's from 68 or something.
69? Yeah, 68.
68. Okay. Yeah. So Bacon did a number of these and. The figure is largely based on Henrietta Moray's, whom we discussed in the third unrelated program that was definitely not a third part. And so he commissioned John Deacon, the photographer, fashion photographer and journalist, photojournalist, to take some photographs of Henrietta in the nude, and he painted from these, where he used them as reference points. So this is obviously not very realistic. And he was questioned about why did you put in the hypodermic syringe? And he said, in an interview with David Sylvester, he said, basically, I wanted something to pin the image to the canvas. I wanted something to make it real, something to make it sort of actual, to hold it down. And people have been not entirely convinced by this, but I think it works quite well. And you see these sorts of things. He sometimes uses nails, not with figures so much, but sort of nails in walls and so forth, just to sort of, and you've seen the use of the safety pin. You'll remember the safety pin from the first program. So yeah, this is like a recurring motif.
Or the arrow, you know, when he uses this sort of floating arrows as a kind of device. I mean, here the arrow is, you know, again, a syringe. And I mean, this is so peculiar. I mean, one of the weirdest things he said, I will have to sort of paraphrase. But, you know, of course, people made the suggestion that this is a drug, this is an overdose, or this is a drug addict, you know, on a bed. I mean, it's 1968 or also. So that subject would have been, you know, was something that was being broached publicly. And he said, no, absolutely not. As Mr. Adams says, I needed a way to pin her to the bed, and I couldn't put a nail there, so I put a syringe. You couldn't nail her to the bed, but you could pin her to the bed with a syringe. Very odd.
I believe him because we've seen this right the way through.
Yeah.
Even the frames in a way have like a kind of can I put it what's the word I'm looking for? Not like stabilizers on a bike, but you know what I mean. It's just like they're kind of practical. They have a practical purpose for his own painting, if that makes any sense. And it seems like
you lost the image, by the way. I don't know
what's happened to it.
I don't know. It's just black, as far as I can see.
Black. Yeah. It's all black.
Lost it. Okay. It's black.
There it is.
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. You got it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So he's always including sort of incidental details. So he has the drama. So he has the sort of the stasis of the room, and you've got like the sort of little bit of decoration. Then you've got the action. Then the convulsion of the figure, which is quite sort of bloody and inchoate, and then he will include a little object to sort of give you a bit of realism, a touch of verisimilitude. So he'll have the cigarettes and the ashtray, or he'll have the syringe, or you know, you'll see a bit of furniture, and we've lost the image again. Oh, yep. It's back.
Okay. All right.
Also, and Henrietta Meret said, oh, this wasn't related to my life. But later on, it foreshadowed, after Bacon died, she apparently became involved with drugs and I think heroin. So she sort of saw this as a prophetic image. I don't know how much we should take from that.
And also, in that image, one other thing, of course, is that you see these sort of vigorous vertical stripes, and we saw them, of course, in the famous image of one of the popes. You know, these very strident sort of vertical lines, and I like here that they've sort of transformed themselves into a period correct. You know, vertical window shade, you know, those sort of vertical Venetian window shades, that those sort of lines of force have been domesticated into late 1960s decor, shielding the scene, or screening it off, which is quite a curious transformation.
And I think, again, it's been mentioned in the literature, but this is sort of related to Soho and the idea of a live bed show, because this is almost literally what you've got. You've got a bed on a stage, you know, surrounded by sort of curtains, and then you're looking at it through, you know, sort of a screen or a box or something. And he did actually do a couple of pictures of sort of watchers or observers, people sitting on seats, apparently watching things. So I think there was a painting called, there was a dwarf sitting on a stool, and he was sitting next to some sort of convulsion in a sort of glass case. And this was sort of seen as, you know, the observer and the sex show, which was seen as sort of, you know, a typical scene of Soho degradation, which seems a fair assessment. So yes, so here we have a bullfight. This is from 69, isn't it?
It is. Study for Bullfight number 1, 1969.
Yeah, so anyone who went to the Royal Academy exhibition of Bacon last year, I think it was, yes, last year, last spring, I believe, you will have gone into the sort of, there's the octagonal room, which had, I think, three of the bullfighting pictures. I think there's only about sort of four or so, four single ones. I think there's a couple of triptychs that include bulls. But that made a terrific impact, and it's incredible to see them in such a small space and to be surrounded by them in a space that was a bit like an arena. Obviously it was, you know, smaller than an actual arena, but it had that sort of circular quality to it. And they painted the walls, I think it was sort of turmeric yellow or something. It was a fantastic display. And here we have one of those scenes. This is something that he took up a little bit. So it was the idea of the bullfighter. He was quite interested in the power of bullfights as an ancient myth, as an ancient fertility rite. He was a friend of Michel Liris, the surrealist and friend of Picasso, who wrote quite a bit on bullfights and ancient rites. And here in this background you also see a scene from the 1930s from Germany. So this is a scene from a rally, and so he's transposed a scene from the 1930s into this bullfighting scene.
And of course, the corrida takes place in this circular arena, as Mr. Adams stated. But you know, it again takes on the sort of the site of a primal scene for Bacon, whether it be the bed in the midst of, you know, one of these circular rooms, or this sort of rich ancient ritual being enacted again and again between the man and the beast, you know, before a crowd, you know. And so and again that Bacon is making, you know, you can make analogies, you know, to the figures of two men in a bed or two men in a field, or, you know, and the man and the bull in the arena, that, that you have this sort of this challenge, this sort of clash of primitive and primitive power and the power of man and this display of sort of dominance and skill. So yes, I think it was certainly a subject that's broad. And of course, you know, that it's also a challenge of life and death. Well, bullfighters, you know, are frequently killed. And of course, the bulls are killed as well. So again, it's no laughing matter.
Yeah, and this is obviously a test of the man's bravery, but I think in Spanish bullfighting, if you read Hemingway on this, he talks about the bull is going to be slaughtered anyway. The bull is superfluous. What is wanted is the cow, wanted for the meat and for the milk. The bull, you have to have bulls for breeding, but there are surplus bulls, so the bull has to be culled anyway. The bull is going to be killed. It's a question of the bull showing his quality. And it is up to the bullfighter, the matador, to bring out the best qualities of the bull, to bring out its strength and its speed and its bravery and its resilience before it is killed, because it will be killed. So it's not a question of cruelty, as they see it. It's a question of the bull being given a chance to show its quality before it is killed.
And of course, by analogy, the man as well, because we're all, yes, you know, again, we're all fated to be killed one way or the other, you know, whether it's in battle or whether it's in bed, you know, at the end. So, you know, and this is, again, one of those things that the modern consciousness cannot process. The rationalist sort of way of interpreting the world has no possibility of entering into a dialogue with this sort of thing, because it's just beyond the sort of small benchtop tools of rationalism to take apart.
It's also because the bourgeois order, the capitalist order, hates the heroic. One of the recurring themes I found in my, you know, both in Prophet of Doom and also, I've been reading this book by Schumpeter on capitalism, and he's actually trying to like define what is the thing that marks the bourgeois capitalist order against all other orders, and it is total distrust and fear of the category of the heroic in general, which is basically what you guys are talking about.
Absolutely. Yeah. It's 100%. It's to do with not allowing bravery and not allowing us to confront death and heroism. Yeah, that absolutely has to be blocked off, because, of course, once that becomes accepted, then, of course, you have the possibility of not only the great man, but the great man, you know, giving rise to a movement, to an army, to violence, to bloodshed, to change, for people sort of to enact heroism through action, which is what the technocrats cannot bear.
Exactly. And it's a threat. It's an implicit, yes, threat. And the thing is, I mean, the wonderful consolation is that this cannot be suppressed. Eventually, this aspect of the spirit, in some form or the other, in some extraordinary men, will manifest itself again. It just cannot be suppressed forever. You know, but I mean, again, you think about the spectacle. You know, what were heroes in 2020? Well, heroes were rioting mobs, or heroes were people putting on masks and waddling to the supermarket. You know, those were our heroes.
Our NHS.
Know, dancing nurses, exactly. You know, those are heroes. The unitary man, in this ritual of blood and power and death, that isn't the hero. You know, that's someone to be reviled. That's something to be suppressed. We've got to get rid of this. We've got to get rid of all manifestations of this. And you know, I mean, I think it's very stark. And of course, it just shows this complete clash of worldviews. And it's no coincidence that, of course, one of the sort of influential artists for Bacon was Picasso. And Picasso was absolutely obsessed with the the corrida, with the bullfight, with the matador, with the power of the boar, the minotaur, or, you know, all of these subjects he returned to again and again and again through his throughout his entire career.
And I think Bacon and Daniel Farson, who was his first biographer, I can't remember if it was him or not. They talked slightly disparagingly about the bullfights because they thought, well, if you're not actually Spanish or, you know, sort of South American, where they have bullfights also, and they have them in Mexico and so forth. If you're not actually of that culture, you can't paint this without it seeming a bit like a tourist poster. Which I think is a failing on their part. I don't think that they understood the aspect that we've talked about just now. I don't think they recognise that aspect in Bacon quite in a way that they should, because otherwise they would see that the bullfight is sort of absolutely, it absolutely meshes with the rest of what Bacon was doing and saying.
Yeah, and I don't want to spoil anything, but Bacon's final completed painting is an image of a bull, which we will see later on at some point. The other thing that this reminds me of is something I remember you talking about, is that one of the most absolutely appropriate monuments to our hideous managerial world is, do you know how on Wall Street in New York that it was placed there in the 80s, I believe, there was a bronze sculpture of a bull. And then sometime in the 2000s, someone placed a bronze sculpture like of a little girl standing in front of the bull. And they loved that.
With her hands on her hips.
Yeah, with her hands like a sassy apart. Little girl standing in front of this gigantic sculpture of a bull. And they loved that image, you know. The little girl challenging
defiant the bull. Defiant little girl, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Yes. You know, absolutely. And I think it says everything about the conflict of these worldviews, you know. I hate that so much. Okay.
So we're back to the self-portrait.
Yeah, 1969 self-portrait.
Yeah, and as you remember, this was given to Valerie Beston, Valerie from the gallery. So that was the manager of the Marlborough Gallery, where he exhibited from the 59 or 60 or so, right through until his death. Despite receiving a few offers from other dealers in the late 80s or early 90s, because by that time, of course, Bacon was a superstar. He was the most valuable living painter, and he was getting offers from other galleries. I mean, this is slightly later than this period, of course, because we're sort of 69-70, but he did not transfer despite being offered favorable terms. This is tied into the case that he had with the case that his estate had with Marlborough, which was settled out of court just days before it was due to go to court. But Valerie from the gallery will play a part in an episode which is going to be coming up very soon in Bacon's life.
Indeed. This picture also sold fairly recently for an absolutely extraordinary amount of money. Which I actually got a slide of at the end, just when, you know, when we can talk about sort of Bacon's market for his pictures. All right. So we have entered the 1970s. This was taken by a famous photographer called Henri Cartier-Bresson in 1971. And a great sort of, again, another sort of turning point in his career, one way or the other. And I've got a painting from 71 that was done prior to the big event, which of course was a major retrospective in Paris at the Grand Palais. And this was again one of those moments in Bacon's career where, I mean, he'd already had a retrospective Tate, and now of course he's had this. It was given the honor, and he was only the second living artist to be given, a non-French artist to be given this honor, and the other, of course, being Picasso, of this great retrospective exhibition in France. So, you know, again, cementing his position as one of the most important living artists, an important figurative artist of the 20th century.
We should also mention that people may not remember, we talked about it earlier, but he was spending a little bit more time in Paris, and during the 70s he actually bought himself, or quite complicatedly, he got someone else to buy for him a small flat in Paris, because he used to visit Paris very often. He would fly, this was before the Channel Tunnel, he would fly from Heathrow to Paris, and he would sort of spend a week or two there. So he would divide his time between London and Paris. And this this studio never got as messy as the one as you see in London. And I think he always had a problem working in other places. Do we mention Narrow Street later on, Mr. D, or...?
No, I don't. And also, I have a picture of the Paris studio, but I didn't put it into the deck. But yes, it certainly looks completely different from his studio in London. But you can talk about it. Yeah.
Oh yeah. So he was spending time in Paris. He would go down to Monte Carlo every so often, because you remember he went there. He lived in Monte Carlo in the 1940s on and off. Now he was visiting it occasionally. He would drive down, remarkably, he would drive down from London with Dennis Worth Miller, the painter of the dogs, and his partner Richard Chopping, the illustrator who illustrated the first edition covers of the James Bond novels. And so they would drive often through Paris and so forth, but they would go to the south of France, and they would go to Monte Carlo. This was also a time when, I'm not going to get ahead of myself, but there was his relationship with George Dyer was breaking down at this time. So it became quite rocky. He was getting quite fed up with George Dyer, it was not so much that he was taking money, because Bacon had money to give now. So he was becoming quite well off, and George Dyer was becoming more and more of an impediment, that he was becoming drunk, he was causing scenes, he was destroying more work than Bacon felt he could allow to be destroyed, because now he had more commitments, he had more exhibitions, he had this big show coming up in Paris, so he needed new work, he wanted to paint some pictures especially for it, and George was getting in the way, he was drinking too much, he was becoming troublesome. And in 1970, in September, Dyer planted some cannabis in Bacon's studio, and he alerted the police. And so when the police arrived, they found this cannabis, because they had a search dog, because of course, if you lose a tiny amount of cannabis in Bacon's studio, you're not going to find it just by looking for it, because it's absolute chaos. So they had to bring in a dog, and the dog found the cannabis. And Bacon said, well, this isn't mine. I don't take drugs and I don't smoke. He did actually smoke. I'm not sure about cannabis, but he used to take all sorts of he would take sleeping pills, and then he'd take other things as well. He'd take painkillers and so forth, because he was sort of medicating his asthma. But anyway, Bacon gets busted for cannabis. He calls in Lord Goodman, who's formerly head of the Arts Council, who was a very, very high powered establishment lawyer, basically. He was the lawyer for the government. And he stood up and managed to get, the court case was that sort of Bacon said, you know, I have this handyman, and he's been going through some troubles, and he arranged this problem for me, but I don't blame him for it. So obviously he wasn't completely coming clear about who George Dyer was, but ultimately Bacon was let off in June 1971 following this incident.
Yes, and of course, you know, as Mr. Adams said, the relationship between Bacon and Dyer had been breaking down for years, and they really rarely saw each other. You know, Bacon was giving him enough money to keep himself drunk all the time. But that was, that was sort of the extent of it. And of course, this sets the stage. You know, Bacon was also preparing for this, for this great honor of this retrospective exhibition in Paris. So if you want to go to the next slide, I just threw one picture in. This is from earlier in 1971, sort of before the subsequent events that we're going to talk about. This is two men working in a field. We're getting a sort of, another sort of variation. This is something that will come up in some of the 70s and 80s picture, which is, of course, the suggestion of an exterior, the suggestion of, and if you think back to the sort of very dark black landscapes, the landscape of Tangier, I believe it was, there's another dimension, I think, that starts to appear in his work.
This is quite an unusual picture. It was exhibited recently at the Gagosian Gallery in, I think it was 2019. If you look up my Gagosian Gallery review, you'll see that I mention it. It actually turns up in a poem that I wrote about in my book After Bacon. I will not subject you to a reading of that poem because I'm not a very good reader of my own poems, but you're free to pick up the book yourself. By the way, I didn't select this image. All the images are D's, essentially, so I didn't set this up.
Yeah. And you also note that there is a strange similarity between the morphology of these two figures and the figure of the Eumenides that we have seen in another form and that we'll see later on. This strange, almost kind of plucked turkey or chicken, perhaps disguising their true nature under these hats.
Also, it's interesting that he does occasionally do these figures where you have the two figures lying next to each other. So this is related to sort of sex and relationships and contentment and losing the self in the sex act. So you're there with, well, in his case, of course, it was homosexual. So it was a man lying with a man. So you could sort of visibly or physically duplicate each other by just sort of lying in a similar position and being the same body type. But this is related to his idea of, his sort of unspoken idea of finding the self through losing yourself in someone else. And I also would relate that to work and laboring. So here we have two figures that become each other, not through sex, but through the work. The physical work, the fact that they are having to use the same tools to do the same job, and they are naturally replicating certain forms and certain actions because this is how the work is done most efficiently. And it's a very interesting way of the ego being lost through sort of comradely work as well as through ego destroying sex.
Penetrating the earth with their tools.
Something like that.
Okay, if you want to go to the next one. So here we see Bacon at the dinner, the opening dinner for this exhibition in Paris in 1971 at the Grand Palais. And it was a big affair. I believe that he even gave a tour to the French Prime Minister, who was it Gestang? Can't remember who was Prime Minister at that time.
Yes, I think it was, yeah.
Gave him a private tour through the exhibition. So it was certainly a great event in Bacon's life. Now, you wouldn't know it, of course, by Bacon's outward appearance, the sort of press junkets that he did. He spoke about his art, he went to dinners, he appeared at the opening of the show. But something had happened, of course, on the night before the opening of the show.
I believe it was two nights before, which has recently come to be unearthed. Yeah.
So George Dyer had traveled to Paris with Bacon, and they actually had a they were sharing a hotel room, and as far as I can recall, on this night, that Dyer had gone out, and was extraordinarily intoxicated, and come home with an Algerian rent boy, of some description, and that apparently Bacon complained that he smelled bad, whether that was, you know, some sort of bodily odor, or it may have been a reference to hashish or something that they were taking. I don't know, but so Bacon went to spend the night in another room with, I believe, an employee of the Marlborough Gallery, to get away from Dyer and this fellow. And the next morning, the 24th of October, Bacon went back to the room, he and Dyer's room, with Valerie Feaston and Terry Danziger Miles. Yes, it was the Marlborough employee that he had found refuge in his hotel room, and they entered the room and discovered that sitting on the toilet was George Dyer, dead, and he had died at some point in the night, and this, you know, again, he and Bacon had this extraordinarily stormy but intense relationship for the better part of a decade. And yet, of course, Bacon did not allow this event to affect his exhibition in any way. You know, again, from outward appearances, you would never have known. And in fact, went to great pains to have this George Dyer's death kind of suppressed, covered up, you know. Yes, I don't know if was it totally out of the media?
No, what happened was it was suppressed. They basically taught Valerie from the gallery, Miss Beston. She spoke to the hotel manager, and I believe he spoke to, well, anyway, it was arranged that basically the room would not be cleaned and Dyer's body would not be found for another 24 hours to basically give time for the event to actually get underway, so that the news would actually be released while there was the sort of press event, or sort of, you know, it would be sort of, you know, it would be or mentioned the next day or something like that. So they actually interfered with the process of the body being found because they didn't want to have the opening, this spectacular event, disrupted by obviously the scandal of the death of this young man who was, you know, technically just a handyman, who was a, you know, quote, friend of the artist. Of course, everyone at the event, of course, knew who George Dyer was, or at least they knew his face. So if it had come to light, it would have been, you know, it would have overshadowed the work and the event.
So, and of course, there were many, many pictures of Dyer in the exhibition, you know, keep in mind.
And Bacon thought it was a deliberate overdose, and people who knew him also thought it was a deliberate overdose. They said that he had tried to commit suicide before, and that this time he'd been so out of it, and he'd been so sort of angry that he'd done it deliberately, they think.
I'm just intrigued that he managed to do the whole OD on the toilet a full 8 years before Elvis, or 7 years before. I mean, isn't that basically the same? Didn't Elvis die on the loo of an OD?
Yes, Elvis famously died on the loo. I mean, you know, it just so happens. This is what often occurs. I mean, the official cause of death, by the way, turned out to be, yes, acute barbiturate intoxication with alcohol, and with the involvement of alcohol, and which was a common way to go. I mean, it's what finished off Marilyn Monroe. It's what finished off quite a number of people during that time. Barbiturates are very dangerous, certainly when mixed with another CNS depressant like alcohol, and frequently people would just they would pass out, you know, often in the loo.
Did they rule it was a suicide? Or
I think it was open, but yeah.
I think that was the of course the suspicion. But I don't know.
It wasn't treated as a suspicious death.
No, it wasn't
accidental or suicidal. I mean, they couldn't decide.
Yeah.
Well, obviously, it was a French, and it was of the inquest. The coroner's inquest would be French because this happened in Paris. So I don't know quite how they would make that determination.
And I believe Dyer's, that you know, Bacon paid Dyer's body to be. Be sent back to Britain quite quickly after the police were finished. But you know, I also don't want to suggest that Bacon, that this didn't affect Bacon, because it affected him very deeply and very, very quite enormously, as we will see with you know, just evidenced in his subsequent work. I mean, as he said, there were people dying around him all the time at this point, of course. And he had just suffered the loss of his nanny, who we mentioned in previous installments.
And his mother died on the 14th of April, 1971.
Hmm. And I believe that there was someone else as well. So this was quite a difficult time, and certainly the loss of Dyer was a huge blow to him.
John Deacon died in 72.
He certainly didn't talk explicitly about this, but he said that of course after this point that he was haunted by demons, disaster and loss. And of course I mentioned the Furies, Eumenides. This became a sort of a theme that really started to occur in his work from this point on, because of course I think Bacon sort of imagined these tragedies as basically being pursued by the Furies, and which he, I think, in one way or the other, felt for the rest of his life. So, I mean, this was certainly a major change in his work and the way he approached life. You know.
Yeah, as we will see in these paintings. Yeah.
Yeah. So this is a work from 1971 called In Memory of George Dyer. So again, painted the same year of Dyer's death.
Yeah, and I believe that the central part of the painting was actually based on the hotel room where Bacon and Dyer had been staying in Paris. So it was sort of loosely based on that. And what you can see, there's an interesting technical thing here. If you look closely, you'll see at the foot of the figure, you'll see there's some sort of piece of paper. So it looks like a piece of newspaper. And you'll see that there are some letters on that. And these are dry transfer lettering. So if you're sort of in your 30s or 40s, you may remember that you could get these before the advent of sort of computer printers being common. You could get hold of these sheets. I think they still do them. They're sheets of lettering. So you'd have this sort of tough, sort of greaseproof paper, as it were, and there'd be sort of black lettering on it. And you would be able to place this on your paper and you would rub through from the front and it would transfer the letter onto the surface behind. And you could use these for sort of like doing headlines or for sort of writing notices or so on. And what Bacon would do is he would stick the dry transfer sheet over the area that he wanted. So it would often be sort of painted white or sort of tinted slightly. And then he would just rub indiscriminately. So you get like a whole line of R's or a whole line of S's and T's and so forth. And it would be gibberish. It wouldn't mean anything, but it was actually a way of indicating a scrap of newspaper with writing on.
Yeah, I don't think he ever uses it to spell out any words, but he uses it a lot. You will see this device used again and again in paintings, right up to the end. So he happened upon this and used it quite extensively. And of course, other artists have explored the kind of dimension between language and the visual impulse. I'm thinking of like someone like Jasper Johns, sort of exploring when a character, is symbolic and when a character is just marks on its own. When does it signify something and when is it not signify something? So this sort of tension between language and marks, I think is something that probably interests Bacon.
I was just going to say the group of these that you're going to see a sequence of triptychs, I believe, and these are called the black triptychs because they're sort of not this one so much, but they're sort of connected by the use of black paint, and these are related to George Dyer's death.
Yeah, and George Dyer as a character haunts Bacon's work for years and years to come. He continues to appear in Bacon's paintings, haunting his work as well as possibly his own personal mind and his own personal life and his thoughts and feelings about this. It's clearly something that he didn't really get over, despite any sort of any sort of surface indications. The other thing that this picture always reminds me of is that Bacon's home and studio at 7 Rees Mews in London was accessed by a narrow and dark and steep little set of stairs that go up to a landing where there was hanging a lamp from a cable.
Yes, he had bare light bulbs in his room, so he's quite, people used to go over to his flat, and although his studio was very messy, the rest of his flat was quite Spartan, and it was relatively clean. It was clean, yes. Yeah. But he had sort of bare light bulbs hanging from the ceilings. And so someone came to visit him, and they didn't know anything about the fact that he was an extremely rich painter. And they said, oh, dear, he's not doing very well, because they looked at his lamps, and they saw he didn't have any light shades. So they assumed that he was not doing very well. But this was just his choice. He wanted things as stark as possible.
Yeah, and you'll see a bit of his flat in one of the films we're going to watch a bit. This always reminds me a bit of that, even though there's also an analog to how, to the discovery of Dyer's body in the hotel.
I should say there's someone in the chat asking about sort of what about Velasquez and Titian and stuff. And I would say, well, if they're interested, you should subscribe to the Jackdaw, where I write articles on Titian, Velasquez and Ribera and Zurbaran and so forth. And I'm currently writing a book for Prestel on the subject of Johan Vermeer. And I'm a fan of all these artists and a great appreciator. So if you want to read my writings on those great artists, you're quite welcome to do so. There are plenty of them, but this stream is about Francis Bacon, so that's who we're talking about.
I'm going to have to get a Steve Turley alarm or something like a.
And if you want to talk to me about Velasquez and Titian, you'll have to come over for tea. Don't have any books.
I hate to bring the tone down, but you see that the ridiculous fight between Elon Musk and Mark Zuckerberg is slated to actually go ahead, and they're gonna stream it live. Now, I hate to say this, but the left painting here, I reckon he looks a bit like Mark Zuckerberg there, and I imagine that in that fight, if it takes place, the Zuckerberg's gonna look a little bit. He's gonna look a little bit like that.
Well, Zuckerberg's got the reach, hasn't he? Because he's taller than Elon, isn't he?
Well, and he's got the training as well. He's been training like in martial arts or whatever. So, but Elon has got the weight, so it's going to be interesting. But I don't know, for some reason, this figure, it's got the same kind of just looks a bit like Zuckerberg. That's all.
Well, that was based on a photograph of wrestlers, I believe. So yeah, I mean that's where you get the sock and the boot from, and the sort of the tight shorts.
Yeah, and then the Zuckerberg. Well, the Zuckerberg element is the kind of dead, like the dead behind the eyes robot face, I guess. Like there's not a lot going on in the face there. All right, let's carry on.
And of course, you know, in this picture, in terms of, you know, like relating it back to Dyer, you know, again, we see him, you know, we see the mangled, the sort of defeated body, the collapsed body of the wrestler, who is wrestling only with his shadow, you know, or has his shadow sort of menaces him. In the middle panel, again, his face, his profile, his identity is dissolved in shadow and darkness. He becomes a silhouette of himself. And in the third panel, he exists only as a reflection. You know, either as two reflections, or a reflection on the table and a painting, you know, of himself. You know, an image of himself. He's an image reflecting an image. So, you know, some very bleak sort of explications of Dyer's character and his circumstances, his ultimate end.
Yeah, I've only just noticed that on the right, the one that sort of, I had always thought of it as like a little puddle running out of the head, but of course it's the base of a table. That's
like a cafe.
But of course it's also sort of like, it's also extruded from the reflection of the head. So
from the head, yeah.
It's got the implication of sort of blood or sort of life fluid running out.
Yeah. Okay, you want to go to the next picture? This is called Triptych August 1972. And again, we recognize George Dyer's appearance certainly quite strongly in the first panel.
People will remember the photographs that we showed them of George Dyer posing in the studio wearing his underwear. This painting, but this triptych belongs to the Tate Gallery.
Yes, and again, this is sort of included in those paintings called the black triptych.
So here we have like it becomes radically simplified, and he was doing this for his sitting portraits of sort of Lucian Freud and so forth, where he had basically just, he would often have just three pictures, three paintings of the same figure in slightly different poses. So it'd be like a mugshot. So you'd have one from the left, one from the right, and one central. Here you've got two from the sort of giving the right profile, and one from the right profile, one from the center, and then here in the middle you've got the wrestlers, as it were. You remember that this comes from the wrestlers, which we saw in the second program, second standalone video, where you've got the two wrestlers from Mybridge, and here it's been reduced, and so this is where he's been using spray paint. So you've got this sort of very delicate gradations in the body, and that's achieved by using spray paint. This would be just an ordinary aerosol can. So we talked about Bacon not having a formal art education. He was using Letraset, which is the dry transfer letters. He was using oil paint. He was using acrylic paint. He'd be using rubbing pastel into the surface of the canvas. And here he was using just spray paint as well. And we've talked about dust as well. So he was using all sorts of different odd materials, which would cause problems for conservatives. I've never heard anyone talking about the conservation of a Bacon painting. I'd be very interested to read about that.
No, and I actually read a lot of conservation literature, and there is very little that I've encountered about the conservation of these pictures. I mean, I think the saving graces that they've been glazed, you know, for most of their existence under glass, and also that they're painted quite thinly, which gives them an advantage, except for the ones that have big blobs of paint on them. But Bacon tended to work very quickly and paint quite thin layers, which produces a slightly healthier paint layer.
So we should mention also that we talked about the size of these paintings. Now they sort of conform to, I think, sort of the golden ratio or something. But these were essentially the size that could fit up the stairs. But obviously they are a good proportion. That these are the sort of proportions that you'd expect from a painting. But he could only work on one painting at a time. So if you see the photographs of him in the studio, you'll see one of these canvases basically fills up over half the width of the studio. So he couldn't have even two paintings side by side. So I imagine what he did was he took measurements, or he got like a ruler and marked out on the ruler where the floor and the wall were supposed to join up, so that he could do this consistently on each painting, because he couldn't put them side by side. There simply wasn't room for them. So he had to do these paintings in turn, which must have created some interesting logistical problems of how he's moving them around the studio while they're still wet. This is sort of quite an interesting thing to think about if you're a painter, the way that me and Mr. D are.
And of course, we also again get these images of George Dyer, you know, eyes closed, almost being swallowed by the darkness, this portal, you know, sitting before this portal, you know, he's sort of almost losing himself. Parts of his body are disappearing. His torso is disappeared into the darkness. And again, the shadow on the floor becomes almost this puddle of flesh, sort of leaching or leaking out of him, or sort of dissolving away from his body. And then and then we get these, of course, these black sloping lines on either wing panel towards the center. Again, everything sort of draining away into this body, which almost seems to be sort of being dragged through the portal, dragged away. They're just extraordinarily redolent of death, these pictures. Let me go to the next one.
Mm-hmm. So what's this one then?
This one is called Figure and Movement. And this is 1972. And again, it's the sort of hints of the physiognomy of George Dyer. You know, and as I said, he becomes a sort of phantom who haunts these pictures. Reading the news, which is just a jumble of letters. You know, again, the body being confused with its own shadow. You know, the kind of figure falling away or being pulled away by its own shadow. So. And of course, these sloping lines suggested by the box and by that sort of black shade coming down over the figure. I just can't help but sort of read all of the paintings proximate to Dyer's death as I said, as being haunted.
Yes, and that is very true, that he started talking in terms of, in interviews, he started talking in terms of explicitly making art that would be autobiographical. So he wanted to paint his life. And he wasn't completely open about who George Dyer was, but obviously he was making these paintings about George Dyer, and he was thinking about him a lot, and he wanted to do a sort of what Picasso did, because Picasso was painting his life. Picasso used to date all his paintings quite religiously, that he would date them like a diary. So he'd date the precise dates when he started and when he finished. So you can actually work out what he's doing on each particular day. And I think that Bacon was interested in this idea of doing a sort of painted autobiography. Now, it never really came through in the end. He never kind of explained it. He was never are that precise about dates and about explaining who the figures were, because sometimes they were amalgams or fantasy figures. But this was certainly on his mind, and he talked about this to David Sylvester.
Okay, we'll go to the next.
So this is the most explicit painting of this, of the death, of the suicide. So you have George Dyer on the right vomiting into the sink, in the centre crouching under the light bulb with the sort of black, sort of lung-like, animalistic silhouette sort of lurching through the door. And then on the left you have the body crouched over, as it was seen by Bacon, dead on the toilet.
Yes, and so of course in the last triptych we saw we saw these three images of kind of metaphorical death, and now Bacon in the final painting of this the so-called Black series has gone with the ignominious, you know, and low and fraught, you know, physical aspect of the death, you know, the dispensation of the body. And of course, now that the figure of Dyer is no longer before the portal or dissolving into it, now he's a figure purely of the darkness, purely a figure lost on the other side of the portal, on the other side of the veil. And yes, I mean, as Mr. Adam pointed out, that extraordinarily menacing shadow, which becomes a bit like, almost a demon, reminds me a bit of some of the sort of ancient Sumerian figures of demons, like Pazuzu, who people may be familiar with that one, because a statue of him is used in The Exorcist from 1972 to sort of depict the demon at the beginning of the film.
Also in the ridiculous sequel with Richard Burton.
Yeah,
Pazuzu, take me too. it's absolutely ridiculous.
Absolutely awful, that film. Yeah. but you know, I find this picture almost sort of, I mean, it's difficult to deal with this triptych. And I've dealt with the death metaphorically. I've dealt with death allegorically, you know, and we deal with the reality of the death, and of course the reality of many, you know, again, that this idea of contrasting the heroic death of the matador, which occasionally happens, with of course the pathetic death of the modern man, you know, alone, you know, on a toilet with his face in a sink, you know, purging himself.
Yes, it's quite pitiful.
Mm. So awful about that, and so pitiful about that, and you know, and it was something that, you know, Bacon had to contend with. I mean, this is something, of course, if you recall some of the Warhol streams, you know, that the idea that Warhol was sort of amusing himself by watching fragile people self-destruct, you know, that without any sort of intervention, without any sort of apparent care for them. Until they, you know, until they died in flames or of an overdose or leapt off of a building, you know. So I think it also brings up sort of uncomfortable questions, you know, less so in Bacon's case, because again, obviously, there's only so much you can do to help someone.
And I think that what you find in Warhol, Bacon, and also Burroughs, I think maybe. If we can, not lining up to talk about to do streams on Burroughs, but that would be quite nice. But you see this way that they incorporating this tragedy, and of course they're making material out of it. They're using it as raw material for art, and you know, in the same way that Picasso did as well. And of course, you know, that Bacon was very much taking cue from Picasso. And of course, you know, he was the death of Picasso's friend Casagemas was supposedly the origin of the blue period. And take that for what you will, but it's true that Bacon he was grieving. He was genuinely upset. He did genuinely feel that he had played a part in contributing to George Dyer's downfall, but he was also making some great paintings, and he was selling these paintings for good money. And these paintings were going onto the walls of museums. These were being reproduced in posters. These were exhibition posters. So he was seeing these pictures, making him more and more famous. And isn't there that phrase about the chip of ice in every good writer's heart, that they're watching and recording the most terrible things going on about them so that they can reproduce them in their art?
And I think there's something so uncomfortable about it, and something that certainly modernity brings to the situation, or whatever you call it, capitalism, exchange, sort of artist commodity and artist luxury. I mean, of course, the artist is going to be motivated by whatever it is, religious feeling, spiritual sort of calling, a vision, an appreciation of the natural world, whatever it is, tragedy, as we see with Bacon. But in the end, of course, it all then, what does it become? Where does it go, and how do we negotiate it? I mean, I feel very uncomfortable with this, even though this is one of Bacon's most famous works, this triptych. As Alexander says, it's reproduced all the time in posters and things. You see people going to, walking through thoughtfully gazing from a discreet distance at these works. And, it's a man who, an utterly broken man who died on the toilet, Yeah. And there's just something very uncomfortable about that. And I've always had this difficulty. And again, you can relate this back to Warhol, where Warhol very explicitly dealt with this. I'm going to make a whole series of photographs of people die who were mangled in automobile accidents. I'm going to make big, colorful, in your face paintings of death, and I'm going to sell them to you, and you're going to buy them. And it's just the same as Marilyn Monroe, another broken figure staring out from a canvas, called glamorous, but in reality, again, a pathetic, broken person. And I'm going to sell it to you, and you're going to buy it, because that's the sole commodity that everything, including death, including despair, can be turned into a commodity. So there is something uncomfortable that I think modernity can't quite reckon with in art.
Yeah, and it's kind of beautifully fitting that I think this was the first painting by Bacon that achieved over £1 million at auction. In the late 80s, I think, or the early 90s, I think it was before he died. So this became like a landmark painting in commercial terms. And nothing sells better than such an iconic image of death.
Okay.
So this was painted in 1973, by the way.
Oh, yeah. It's called Triptych May June. Yeah, it's 1973. All right. So, and of course, during this period in the mid to early to mid 70s, Bacon was also turning to self-portraiture more and more. And of course, does it assume a different character in the wake of these events? You want to go to the next one? So this is Self-Portrait 1973. Which I think is a very interesting image, one often reproduced. But of course, Bacon now puts himself as the figure at the sink, with his arm reaching into the sink, almost to sort of suggest that he's cognizant of the idea of going down the drain. And the focal point in this becomes not sort of an arrow or a syringe, but of course Bacon's wristwatch. Suddenly we have a very obvious and unavoidable sort of aspect of time, time passing, time ticking away.
So this is sort of seen as a sort of an aspect of mortality, the idea of time passing and so forth. He did a number of self-portraits. There is also another one, I don't know if you've got it, of him recovering after having an operation. I think he had a kidney removed. And there's him, there's a painting of him sort of lying on a bed.
That's a later one.
That's from the mid 70s. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. These three studies for self-portrait, 1974. And he quite heavily focused on self-portraiture. You know, again, after the pictures of sort of looking at fire, sort of looking at other people, you know, also looking at his own face, which, as I said on previous installment, that he professed to hate his own face, his own appearance.
And there was also one of him with a black eye.
Yeah.
Because the story was that he apparently fell down while he was terribly drunk in Soho. He fell down some steps.
In fact, I believe that the story was he fell down the stairs that went up to the colony room, and that his eye actually came out of the socket, and that he pushed it back in and went to casualty or accident and emergency.
And he also, there was another occasion when he got a very serious cut, and he had to be sewn up apparently, I don't know why, but it was his personal physician who actually sewed him up. I don't know quite why he wouldn't go to an emergency room for that, but apparently the doctor said, well, you know, I'll give you an anaesthetic, and said, and Beckham said, no, I don't need one. And it occurred to his physician, Paul Brass, I think it was, afterwards, that actually Bacon quite enjoyed the pain. Mm. And this was an aspect of his character. So I think he enjoyed seeing pain and also inflicting pain. He could be quite generous and thoughtful, but he could be quite brutal, and he was certainly an acute observer of pain.
You can't spell painting without the word pain. Sorry, I just had to throw in my own tone-lowering little bomber.
I'll help you with the pain.
You're not alone.
Have we woken you up?
So, well, I've got a headache. I told you, I've got a...
Yeah, he's got a stake. He's got a stake on his head.
I've got the eighth day of a migraine, so I'm just kind of sitting here nursing my temple, looking at a depressing Francis Bacon picture.
Yeah, this is how you feel.
Yeah, this is the experience of the migraineur.
And Bacon, like you, had a lot of trouble sleeping, so he had to medicate himself to get to sleep, yeah, because he was constantly on. He was very hyper, so he had difficulty sleeping.
Well, I hope in 2 days people don't like open the lodge and find me on the toilet. Just hope I make it, you know.
No, don't say it.
I'm just waiting. I am waiting. On the back of the migraine tablets, it says you have to wait 4 hours. So, waiting for my next dose. All right, let's carry on.
Okay. To be fair, since my late adolescence, I have suffered from migraines. I actually get the full. I get the aura. I get the whole experience.
Well, I've been
prodrome and the aura and all of that. So
I've been getting bits of aura. But you see, I've had migraines since I was little.
Oh.
But okay. I have never had. Usually what happens is, I'll be sick, and that will get rid of it, or I'll go to sleep and I'll wake up and it'll gone.
Yeah.
This is the first time I've ever had it, where basically nothing—not Nurofen, not tablets, not—I've never had it last through the combination of food, sleep, eat, tablets, you name it. It's just not going away. So it'll be doctor soon, I reckon. But anyway, let's carry on.
Yeah. Interestingly, I can't remember if it's Oliver Sacks. There has been a lot of writing about the creative impulse and how people who experience migraines. That there is some sort of link between people who suffer from migraines and who are often sort of artists, writers.
Yeah, I also read some interesting stuff. I know that people hate the pathologizing of creativity, but I think at some degree it's unavoidable that that the traumatic head injuries that Hemingway suffered made him quite reckless, because something that you find with people who've had a brain trauma is they become quite emotionally raw and prone to risk taking and so forth. It's interesting that also Augustus John, who's known as sort of the most adventurous of the Edwardian painters, that he suffered a brain injury when he was a youth, well, he was around sort of 18 or 19 or so forth. And he was known as being extremely reckless and quite wild and quite not prompted by social cues. And I think there might be some credibility to the idea that maybe he was that this injury may have stimulated him to become a more ambitious painter, to become less inhibited.
Yeah, you got to be careful with that, because there's a paper which discusses whether Francis Bacon had a very rare neurological disorder that caused him to not be able to correctly resolve the human face.
No,
he had some sort of dysphoria, and I hate that.
No, that's completely wrong, because he did actually do. There are actually a couple of. There's a very, very early portrait where he's done like a complete head. It's a completely natural rendering of a head, well, slightly stylized, but there's nothing that this is a deliberate stylistic practice.
This is not
the case here.
Bollocks. This is so the painting we're looking at is another Three Studies for Self-Portrait. This is much later. This is 1979. So, but again, you know, three quarter head on. I'm also slightly with some of these. I'm also reminded of there are portraits by Anthony Van Dyck of Charles I, which were done to send to Bernini, so that Bernini could sculpt the bust of Charles I, and it is Charles I three quarter head on, and three quarter the other direction. So very interesting, because that you really sort of see the echo of these, and I wonder certainly Bacon would have been aware of that.
Yeah. Also notice that the bright orange is back, cadmium orange is back. Haven't really seen this very much since 44 45 46. So he's been through phases. He had the dark green, he had the dark blue phase, then the dark green phase. We don't tend to talk in terms of him in terms of color. There are some artists who we do, but here we've come out through the sort of the pastels of the 1960s and 1970s, and we're back into the hot orange, which will come to dominate the essentially most of the 1980s.
And the 90s, it never goes away once it sort of re-emerges with a force. So yeah, in fact, we'll see. There's another painting coming up on the slide, so it sort of continues that trend. If you want to move on, so this is a piece of again another piece of studio ephemera, and this is a photograph of a handsome young chap called Peter Beard. And Beard was another one of Bacon's friends and sort of artistic muses. In fact, he was an artist himself, specifically a photographer. Passed away quite recently, 2020, sometime fairly recently. But Peter Beard was of course known for taking for photographing, amongst many other things, Africa and wildlife, animals and such, and so this would certainly have been something that attracted Bacon, as well, of course, as Peter Beard's could look.
So if anyone here knows the album Tusk by Fleetwood Mac, it was Beard's photographs that were used on that. I mean, there's some sort of fancy photographs of the band themselves, but the collages are made from, might even be made by Beard himself. He's particularly famous for his photographs of elephants, and that relates to, one of the reasons why they called the album Tusk. So if you've got the vinyl, I mean, obviously you can't get this on CD really, but you need the vinyl experience of looking at the sleeves of that.
Peter Beard also was quite good, quite a good self-promoter. He for years had a gallery in New York, in New York's version of Soho, which was just sort of dedicated to a sort of evolving display of his own work. I actually met him there once in the 90s. I don't know if it's still going on, but had his own sort of perpetual display of his work. But that, and he was also, of course, some friend and acquaintance with other artists. There's a picture of him standing shirtless on a boat with Salvador Dali, who looks like, you know, who has a face like a smacked ass. But it's quite interesting. But Bacon also produced a number of paintings of Beard. If you go to the next slide, you'll see one of them. This is from 1975. And Bacon produced in quite a lot of portraits in the 70s. You know, mid to later 70s, that was a major part of his output, producing portraits of various people. A couple of them on commission. You know,
And these are quite good likenesses. I think that it's always an open question as to how much of portraiture is down to caricature, because caricature is essentially taking the most notable elements and exaggerating them and combining them in a way that sort of emphasizes those aspects. And there's always a touch of caricature about Bacon, and I don't say that that's necessarily a bad thing, because I think that a lot of effective caricature, you can be quite traditional and paint in a, you know, you might be observed very closely and paint quite well, but I think often a lot of accurate verisimilitude can often be quite dead, and that what you get is, when you have a touch of caricature, as long as you don't go too far, this livens it up, and this makes it more, it makes more of an impression on the viewer when it's slightly exaggerated. And I always think that Bacon's best portraits have got more than a touch of the caricature about them.
Yeah, and I also, in a weird way, relate Bacon to a much earlier British artist called William Hogarth, who again produced, he was known for producing these sort of moral sort of series of pictures. Often began as paintings and then were engraved to be sold by subscription. But he also produced lots of more traditional oil pictures. But there's always in Hogarth's case, he very explicitly did caricature at times. But there's always a hint of that even in his more serious work. There's a curious relationship in that sense. And perhaps there may be, and of course, you know, after Hogarth, there were quite a number like James Gilray.
This is the English, is Rowlandson and all. Yeah, I mean, they're working up to today, and obviously you look at political cartoons, especially British political cartoons, they're full of caricature. But also you've got to remember that some of the most remarkable portraitists of the 20th century, like I'm thinking for example of Otto Dix, it was essentially caricature. Also someone like Max Beckmann's a terrific painter, lots of force, very powerful, and they are extremely simplified portraits. I mean, the self-portraits of Beckmann are incredible.
Yeah, I really love Max Beckmann. Or indeed, of course, again, bringing the tone down or up, depending on how you think about it. Think about the Spitting Image puppets, which are sort of extraordinary three-dimensional character of sort. So I wonder, there is something about British art that that's a thread that runs through British art.
And of course, most politicians of that time actually wanted to be on Spitting Image. It massively increased their profile and made them more real.
Exactly, you know, yeah, they became much, much more sympathetic, even when they weren't, even when their puppets weren't.
This reminds me. There was a comment earlier where someone was asking, "Are they when they were talking about the last George Dyer triptych? Are the paintings in the right order?" Yes, the paintings were in that specific order. He didn't tend to do sort of, you know, earliest one on the left, later one in the middle, and the last one on the right. So you're not reading it from right to left or left to right. Usually it's sort of in a triptych format, so the central one is slightly different from the two wings, and there isn't a particular order to read them in. They were always kept in the same order once they're framed, and Bacon always specified on the back which was on the right, which was the left, and which was the center. They were never moved, there was never rearranged. There were occasions when triptychs, or occasionally diptychs, which he did much more infrequently, were split up. And this was usually because he found one of the paintings didn't work. For whatever reason, he destroyed it, and then he would split up the paintings and they'd be sold individually. This is pretty rare, but it does happen occasionally.
Okay. So next is another portrait of this period, and this is Mr. Adams. Talked about him earlier, the French artist and writer Michel Lyrez. Michel Lyrez, sorry.
Yes, so he was, if anyone's read my recent articles on Bataille, Michel Lyrez comes up. Lyrez was associated with the dissident group of the Surrealists. So you can imagine that there was the main group of the Surrealists, which was André Breton, and Aragon until he defected, but Max Ernst and so forth. They were the core. Elwad as well, the poet. So they were the central core. And then you had a dissident group, which was around Georges Bataille, author of The Story of the Eye and Madame Edouarda, and he was also a sort of quasi-anthropologist and an economist of very some odd ideas about economy. He accrued around him a group of artists, including Salvador Dali was kind of in both camps until he was basically kicked out by both. And Michel Lyrez was most associated with Georges Bataille because he was sort of kind of skeptical about André Breton. Anyway, so Michel Lyrez was kind of, it was very interesting because he spent a lot of time in Africa and worked as an ethnographer before returning to Paris and writing, a very esteemed writer. And Bacon came to know him in the 1960s, I think, and Lyrez wrote quite a good short book on Bacon, which was kind of interesting enough, it was illustrated by a higher proportion of the Paris paintings, because Bacon was painting in London and Paris, but actually more of those Paris paintings tended to turn up in the book written by Lyrez. Lyrez, I don't think, selected the images. But it's quite curious that I think I can spot the Paris paintings because they have a different quality to the canvas. But I might be wrong. I think I'm right.
Okay. this is a picture called the very end of the 1970s. It's called the Oedipus, from 1979. This is to some degree, not exactly, but a sort of mirror image of a figure we saw from 1972, the figure in movement, sort of reading the newspaper. This is sort of a kind of reversal of that same figure. Again, this time with the newspaper being even more blasted and sort of floating away. And this spermatozoa sort of looking Well, with paint, which is, seems to be homing in on a certain aspect of the physiognomy of the figure. A very curious picture, this one.
And so you'll notice that the white dab is almost the last thing. So I imagine what the last thing was. He did the whole painting complete. Then he threw the white dab. And then the very last thing he did was he waited until the white impasto, which is what we call thick paint, he did the little shadow underneath it. So he added that last of all, because you can't throw it in a way that you'll get into that place. So what he did is he threw the white, then he added the little shadow under the white.
And it's quite, you know, again, this is almost get kind of trompe l'oeil effect, because that blob of paint is quite thick, and so it would cast a bit of an actual paint would cast the shadow. But of course, you know, he's doing a little bit of a game by giving it a kind of represented shadow that in the picture.
Yeah, and I think I think it's in the early 80s that he retires this sort of white dab thing that he was doing for sort of 15 or 20 years. I think it became too much of a tick. It became too easy for him. And I think maybe there was some sort of comments by people saying, oh, you know, we've seen that one before. Try something new.
Yeah, but, you know, he certainly abandons it. But although, of course, the next picture is kind of the apotheosis of the idea of throwing.
Oh, okay. Yes, I know what's coming. Yes.
Yeah. So if you want to move on, this is called Jet of Water from 1979. And I always really like this picture because it's such a sort of weird departure in certain ways. But also a kind of literalization, of this idea of, you know, what is the white, you know, what is the white splash, you know. And to actually sort of to make it, you know, into the figure of water. And he did it. There's another painting. I couldn't find a sort of higher resolution image of it. And I didn't want to put my catalog resume on in the scanner, but which is a sort of water flowing out of the sink, which is actually quite beautiful as well. But
yes, it's beautiful. So what he did is he said that. He discussed this with David Sylvester, and he said that, you know, he painted this sort of armature, which is sort of like a tubular sort of, you know, tubes or railings or something. And this is the sort of thing you'd find on the deck of a ship. And he mixed up the paint, and he has had it in a bucket and threw it on. And it's quite high risk because you can't really correct it, not with the way he painted it. So and he did a couple like this.
Yeah, there's at least one other one, and he sort of explored this idea of using sort of a flow of water, the flow of paint as the sort of subject of the picture. And the other pictures of this that are related to this also have the same odd sort of armature. Mm.
And also, you'll remember he was casting some shade on Jackson Pollock. So Jack the Dripper, as he was colloquially known in the 1940s and 50s. So he was famous for putting the canvas on the floor and going over it and sort of splashing and speckling and throwing lines of paint and sort of walking over the paint surface. And Bacon, of course, was sort of, you know, oh, that's not real paint. That's not real painting. That doesn't have any meaning. It's abstract. So it's just decoration. It's lace. He's just a lace maker. So here he is. So he disses him, and then he basically sort of, you know, says, oh, I can do it better than you. I can do it in a meaningful way. Yeah. And so here he is throwing his own paint and sort of getting to make it meaningful, but also getting the energy and the excitement and the unpredictability and the macho-ness, because there's a, you know, degree of macho-ness about doing this, about outdoing Pollock. You know, Pollock never did this. I did it better than Pollock, in the same way that he did sort of all these, you know, maroon walls. He did it better than Rothko because he added it, because he did it with a figure. He did it with a figure of George Dyer in his death throes. So he's making Rothko's color is color walls meaningful by adding a figure, by adding action, by adding human interests? And here he's making Pollock better than Pollock, more meaningful than Pollock, because he's talking about the natural world. So I always think that with Bacon, he's always scorning something publicly, and then privately he's just sort of, you know, trying to one-up them.
Well, it's also a very postmodern impulse, you know, again, to take something, you know, sort of quote-unquote authentic, like the, you know, as the abstract expressionists like to present themselves, you know, that they're sort of momentary slashes and splashes and such were the kind of harnessing and distillation of their raw feelings and their authentic nature as a sort of feeling man, you know, to turn that into sort of a visual joke. Although I will say that this picture also reminds me of a couple of David Hockney pictures, which are very well known. The most well known, called The Biggest Splash, which is 1970
or 71 or something like
yeah.
that. It's before the, this.
Oh, before this. Cool. Yeah. And again, that picture is also a slight sort of joke, a visual joke, that, you know, that you get the sort of abstract splash related to this sort of expressionist impulse. But of course, it's a splash from a swimming pool, and it's also very meticulous. In Hockney's case, it wasn't thrown on there. It's very meticulously painted. But I do wonder if Bacon was perhaps unconsciously channeling the Hockney, because he certainly
That's a really good call. I'm sure that played into it. I think Bacon was, yeah, he was also lifting a bit from Hockney, at least the idea of having this splash right in the center.
Yeah. All right. So we'll leave the 1970s and we get into AA's favorite decade, forged in the steel of the 80s, which doesn't make any sense.
Absolutely. And see the man on the right reading, on the left reading the Hi-Fi magazine.
I love this bit. This is my favorite picture of Bacon. This is the idea of Francis Bacon on the tube.
It's interesting how little the tubes are trains, really, isn't it?
which may be an indictment of of the tube, but
what happened with this photograph was that Bacon was photographed on the train. This wasn't set up, so it was just a photographer.
It was a
professional photographer who happened to have his camera with him, and he recognized Bacon, and it's like, oh yeah, I'm gonna get myself a couple of candid shots. So he took, I think, at least one photograph, and it was published. And the next day, Bacon wrote into the newspaper or the magazine and said, "Oh, can I have a copy? Because I really like it."
Yeah, it's a great picture. I didn't know. I thought it was actually set up.
No.
Because of course you get also the blurring of his face, which is slightly, you know, reminiscent of things. And that suede coat is quite amazing. Yeah, I mean, as we said, Bacon was quite an admirer of, you know, dressing well.
So as I said, my title for this stream was going to be Suede and Corduroy. he used to wear suede sometimes. He had suede. He had those sort of suede Chelsea boots, yeah, or desert boots. And people recount an incident where he was with John Edwards, who I imagine will turn up in the next.
In the
next few minutes. He knew someone called John Edwards, and John Edwards was wearing a corduroy jacket, and Bacon was sort of stroking the jacket and saying, "I'll paint with that," because as we saw in the last stream that wasn't a precursor to this one, that's. He would dab paint onto textured fabric, and then apply that to the painting, and the pattern would transfer to the painting. So he was using all sorts of odd ways of applying paint, and corduroy was of course extremely popular in the 70s. Ended up in a way, sort of t- turning up in his art indirectly.
I still have a couple of corduroy jackets that I put in the rotation. So. All right, yeah, the next one is just another picture of Bacon from the time period. I just sort of periodically include these photographs because I think it's interesting to see the sort of progression of the artist's face, you know, over the decades.
Oh, he used to dye his hair quite regularly. So you'll see all sorts of different hair colors. So he goes from blonde to you know, all sorts. Yeah,
there was a sort of red hair period. And
also he was reputed to have had some facelifts as well, and at a time where it was quite rare to have facelifts. Mm. That was unconfirmed.
Unconfirmed. Shouldn't be surprised. Okay. So next up is, this is Three Studies for a Portrait of John Edwards from 1980. And this this fellow, the model for this picture, became, I would say, a sort of very important figure in Bacon's life. And, of course, after Bacon's death as well, for reasons we'll talk about later on. But so I don't know how to characterize their relationship. I don't know if their relationship was ever explicitly sort of a romantic or sexual one. I mean, I suspect probably in the beginning it was, but it's difficult to say because the character of his sort of relationship with Edwards was much more kind of paternal than it was with Dyer. You know, I mean, Edwards was a very different type of man than Dyer in a way. But you know, there's a sort of great affection that you always see when you see sort of clips and photographs of Bacon and Edwards together. But again, I don't know how exactly to characterize the sort of full nature of how they owned relationship.
Yeah, so you're quite right. I also struggle, and I think the biographers also struggle because I've read most of the biographies. So John Edwards was the son of a publican in East London, and the story was that what happened was he was running the pub with his brothers, and someone had said, or Bacon had said, to someone there at the pub, "Oh, we're going to come up, and I'm going to bring up some of my friends from the West End. We're going to come up to the East End." So for people who don't know, the West End of London was quite sort of upper class and swanky, and that's where the money was. And East End was working class, white. At this time it was white. You know, quite poor. You know, this was where the dock workers, the factory workers and so forth were. And so John Edwards got in all this champagne for Francis Bacon. Francis Bacon never turned up. And this left them with a whole bunch of champagne, which people in the East End didn't really drink because it was a fancy West End drink and it was also expensive. And so he was so ticked off at Bacon, he somehow sort of either got in contact with him or, I think he went out, he confronted him somewhere in the West End and said, "Oi, mate, you know, we got in that champagne for you and you never flipping well came around for it. What are you going to do about it? You're going to pay us off or something?" And Bacon was so sort of taken with the young man that he sort of became interested in him. They became close. I think there was attraction to begin with. I don't know how far it went, but he later on, it became quite explicitly a paternalistic relationship. So John Edwards became his friend, his companion. He became a fixer. So he's got Valerie from the gallery handling his money, handling his technical stuff, and then his domestic stuff is being handled by John Edwards. John Edwards is acting as a sort of sounding board, you know, because he was quite shrewd. He was illiterate, but he was quite shrewd about people, and so Bacon liked to have him around to get John's opinions on people, and he would take him quite seriously. And people assumed that John Edwards was around for the money, but he wasn't really. I mean, he had a bit of money of his own, sort of, but that wasn't really it. And also, John Edwards was a much calmer character. So Lacey was a violent psychopath, essentially. Dyer was this sort of sad, troubled, dysfunctional alcoholic. But John Edwards was much more based and, well, sorry, much more grounded, sorry. And so he became a sort of help companion. He became a model. Obviously, he wasn't modelling directly because Bacon didn't work directly from the model. But so, yeah, John Edwards became an important part of Bacon's life, especially.
He lived quite near Bacon, and he, I think, almost daily, basically, went up to Francis's flat, and they, you know, I mean, they, you know, he sort of looked after him, you know, because of course Bacon was, you know, was now entering his 70s by this point, so. And also, as you say, Edwards was, I mean, whereas George Dyer was quite, lacked a lot of confidence and was sort of pushed around a bit by Bacon, Edwards, by all accounts, you know, when Francis was in one of his bitchy moods, Edwards just basically threw it right back at him and it wouldn't have any of it. So, you know, he sort of, Bacon also sort of met his match with Edwards. But again, I think their relationship certainly evolved. I know that that later on in the 80s, Edwards had his own boyfriend, whom he lived with, I believe. So, you know, but of course he was still, again, a companion and protector of Francis
and Bacon. And Bacon would have his own lovers as well. So,
yeah.
Which should say, actually, he... Okay, so Bacon at this time also had a second... Okay, right. Bacon had lots of houses by this time. It was odd because he didn't really use them very regularly. So he had his regular flat at Rees Mews, which was actually sort of too small for him. It was kind of, you know, it was kind of inconvenient, but he stayed on there. But he thought, well, I'm going to get somewhere grander that I can really fit out, because he never really decorated his own flat. So he bought a house in Narrow Street, which is Limehouse. So that's in the docks, that's in East London. And he would go there occasionally. He got it all tricked out in a very, very modernist style. And then he found he was paralyzed. He couldn't work there because you'd get reflections from the river because it was right on the Thames. And so he'd have these reflections coming through the glass, and he couldn't work because it was just like, you know, like you're living in a glitter ball, as it were, a mirror ball. And he couldn't work there at all. So what happened was he sold the house in Narrow Street, and he got the house in Narrow Street specifically because he wanted to be in that sort of East End milieu, because at the time there was still working docks, there were still East Enders, there were still Cockneys there. It was just on its way out when it was just starting to reach the sort of the post-industrial decline. But there were still a few ships and a few working people there. Also, he had a house in Wivenhoe, which is in either Sussex or Essex. It's on the border there, which he didn't really use at all. He would go over to see Dennis Worth Miller and Richard Chopping. He bought a house briefly for George Dyer in Newbury, but which was never used and then sold on. He had his flat in Paris, which he did use occasionally, but not that often. And he gave that up in 79 or so, which was when he gave up the Narrow Street house.
Mm. Yeah, there was a farmhouse as well. Was that the one that was in Sussex?
He bought for John Edwards the farmhouse in Suffolk, I believe.
Okay. So, yeah, I mean, so of course, and as you know, as obvious, I mean, Bacon was quite well to do by this point, so you know. So I think this is a good time to watch a clip, which you can see Bacon and John Edwards interacting with David Sylvester in the kitchen of 7 Rees Mews, which is fascinating. And he mentioned, I think I've left the bit in where he talks about the house and studio on Narrow Street. So AA, the file is called Bacon, John Edwards, David Sylvester. something like that. Yeah, we lost him.
No, I'm just trying to find it.
Oh, okay.
There.
I wish you could have another. I wish you could have an old-fashioned corkscrew. Now they've made everything so new. It used to be much simpler when you just put the corkscrew in and pulled out the cork, than now that you have to turn two things to get the cork out. Yes, well, it is opening at last, yes. Am I going to be the only one drinking?
When we go out to dinner and you say you choose something, and I, in order not to make it too extravagant, choose a very good second growth. You sort of grudge your way through the first bottle and then say, let's have something proper now, and order Latour or Lafitte.
I see. Well, I don't know.
I think you're actually as difficult to please over wine as you are over painting. You don't like much of your own, you don't like much of anybody else's, and you only like the very, very best.
Let's agree to that, then.
Don't you, when you're out with Francis, constantly feel slightly humiliated by the feeling that you're both eating the same thing, and you're quite enjoying it. And he suddenly says, this is terrible. Does this happen to you?
Many a time, yeah. It's better than other places.
Well, I like the good food I was brought up with. I mean, my mother, living in Arnhem, we used to have very, very simple, good, but very simple food. Things like oxtail and shepherd's pie and all those kinds of things, which were absolutely delicious when they're properly cooked. They say wine doesn't make any difference. By accident, I was drunk, of course, and I made a marvellous stew. I had a very good thing, and I put a bottle of Petrus into it. As the Petrus was then £90 a bottle or something like that, mind you, it was only because I was well pissed, that I put it in. But that's how it was a very good stew, do you remember?
Very nice, yeah. You like the food though, Dave, didn't you?
Yes, of course he does. Loves it.
There's more drink for you.
I'll have a little more, John. Have I got some? Give me a little.
Lovely. Would you want
wine? Oh, yes, please. Thank you.
Is there any rhyme or reason in the pictures on the wall? Or, I mean, are they there very much by choice?
Yes, they are. There are some of the pictures, not all of them, which I've done recently, which I rather prefer. And then I like looking at them for this reason, that like other pictures and like other things I look at, they're always a kind of visual stimulus that I think, oh, well, why didn't I do this in another way or in a better way? And so they suggest all sorts of other images. So that's the reason I have them stuck up there.
One of the things I see that you've got here is the painting of the sand dune.
Ah, yes. I know it's a painting that you like, and it's curious enough that lots of people say to me, for some reason, that they think it has to do with the human body. But I must say, I have never thought of it in that way. I just thought of it as a sand dune.
And you painted it with the dust from the studio, did you?
I painted it with the dust from the studio, which is an awful game getting all that dust up from the floor, but there's plenty of dust next door, as you know, stuck to the pictures and everything else. So I just painted, took a cloth and painted and put it on like one would almost onto the wet paint. And then after it was dried, I set it, as one sets a pastel. I see. Because, you see, I haven't got it up here, but a painting that I have of a friend of mine, which is in the Tate Gallery, and his suit looks immaculate. And there's practically no paint on it at all. And it's painted with the dust from the floor. Well, as dust seems to be eternal, seems to be the one thing that lasts forever. One of the things I noticed, and I was very pleased to see this, it seems to be as fresh as when I first put it on nearly 40 years ago.
Good Lord. Where did you find the dust? Let's go in.
Well, the dust I find, well, there's plenty of dust in this place. I mean, there's a mass of dust. Just see, in a few moments, do you see, the dust collects. I don't know if I've got a specially good example of it at the moment, of dust. Just collects anywhere. I just sweep it up if it hasn't collected. The only trouble is, using the pastel, a lot of this dust has become coloured. But look at, you see? Now, that is the perfect colour for a grey suit, isn't it? And that is what is all over his grey suit. And it hasn't altered the slightest bit after 40 years.
It's reasonably tidy at the moment, Francis, isn't it, really?
Well, this is tidy compared to what it sometimes is. John and I really tried to throw out things and tidy them a bit because it just became that you could hardly walk into the place, do you know? It was like having a great dog in here that kept you out. There was so much of it in here. You see, most photographers love the walls here because I've used them as palettes. So, because they like the different colours and things that go onto the walls and onto the door. That's the reason I really will be very sad if I have to leave this place. I feel at home here in this chaos, because also chaos suggests images to me. Not necessarily just that I love living. I just love living in chaos. In any case, I can only be if I go into a new room, in a week's time, the thing is in chaos.
You're not a dirty person, just untidy, really.
I like things to be clean. I don't want my cups and things.
Oh, no.
I don't want the plates and things to be filthy dirty. But nevertheless, I would like it. I like a chaotic atmosphere.
Mm-hmm. So there we go.
A lot to unpack in that.
Quite interesting. I mean, especially how much the guy is like Clement Freud.
Sounds exactly like him, yeah.
He really, and he even looks a bit like him as well.
Oh, we should explain that's David Sylvester, for anyone who hasn't seen the earlier parts.
Bacon had a type, you know, and of course Edwards very much fitted that
did you see the little dig that John Edwards had about David Sylvester?
Oh, you about eating?
Yeah, he likes it. You like your food, don't you, David?
You like your food, don't you? And Bacon's like, of course he likes. He loves it. also, of course, the bath in the kitchen, which was a common arrangement for certain types of flats and such. But again, I don't think it's what you would expect of a millionaire artist.
Yes, I remember when I was moved to Berlin, the cheapest flats, the most unconverted flats that you could get in Berlin were the ones that had the bath in the shower, the bath in the kitchen.
Yeah, I mean, it was easier and cheaper to have all the plumbing fitments in the same, you know, in the same.
Well, except for the toilet.
Line.
Although Bacon did talk, he talked quite a bit about interior decoration in the interviews with David Sylvester that were published as a book called The Brutality of Fact. He said that he really loved modernist design from the 1920s and 30s, so the Art Deco style. And he wanted it very spare, and he wanted sort of white curtains made of rubber. I don't know how they would have aged. And then he liked also tubular furniture. He liked glass. He liked things being absolutely sort of pristine and sort of clinical. And he said, you know, his idea of the ideal place would be basically an aircraft hangar just with a toilet at one end. And I think that does feed into the way he arranges his paintings.
Yeah, yes, oddly enough. I mean, it's sort of a analogous with all those sort of spaces. But and of course, all that came back in the 1970s. You know,
open plan living came in.
Living in the locked space, and you know, and of course, in the 1960s, the later 60s and 70s, they started producing a lot of that furniture from the period. They, you know, the super comfort armchairs by Le Corbusier and the Eileen Gray, you know, furniture, yeah. Bookshelves. I mean, yeah.
Yeah, and also you remember the one of George Dyer crouching, and he's surrounded by sort of a unitary construction of sort of sofa parts, curved sofa parts that make a sort of weird circular form. AA asked if it was an ashtray, and I mistakenly said yes. I thought he was referring to something else, but it's sort of basically circular curving parts, yeah, of a sofa that have been arranged into a sort of weird circle, sort of diving circle.
It always reminds me a bit of the conversation pit, which was a sort of architectural feature that came in the 60s and 70s, where you would have a kind, yes, of sunken, yeah, area in the lounge, where there would, it would be sort of surrounded by cushions, and
yes, like a jacuzzi but without any water,
with just a bunch of cushions. What else in there? I mean, I also, so from that video, I mean, also the idea that he, you know, be drunk and then he put a bottle of Petrus. I mean, for people's reference, you know, a bottle of Petrus now, £5,000 or more. Certainly, if you get a good vintage of it, you can pay, you know, £20,000 for it. So, and the idea of, first, the idea of Petrus costing £100 a bottle, and then, of course, Francis Bacon pouring one into a stew. It's just absolutely absurd.
Go on.
Well, I was going to just say the line that stood out for me, stands out for me, is of course that when he says that dust is eternal, you know, and it of course reminds me biblically, you know, from dust you were made, into dust you will return, which is a sort of oddly poignant thing for Bacon. You know,
yeah,
and again, Bacon, the role that dust played in the pictures.
Yes, and Bacon was quite aware of the biblical reference. I mean, he had had some traditional schooling. I mean, he went to lots of when he was at the boarding school and so on forth. He was, you know, he went to sort of religious classes and so forth. But he didn't get that much education because he was homeschooled a little bit, he would have known these references, very common references.
All right, chaps. Well, I'm thinking there's about 35, 40 left, and I'm reckoning that might be one whole episode. What do you reckon for the 80s and the end, essentially? What do you think?
Yeah, sounds good.
Yeah, it will be a slightly shorter. Well, I'm sure we can find a way to fill it up, but
there are a couple of super chats. Machiavelli Sucks to Go says, I took money out of my own account, and the bank asked me what I was going to use it for.
What
did you say? Mind your own business. You're a bank manager, not a, you know, like, not my keeper.
Does he bank with Coutts? Have we got a very rich viewer?
He better be sending bigger super chats than that.
Patrick Casey says, great show. Thank you very much, Patrick.
What, the Patrick Casey?
The Patrick Casey. Yeah. Oh, unless it's an imposter Patrick Casey, in which case, get a life. But I think it is the Patrick Casey. And Holocom Records says, please stop saying bacon. You're making me want an omelette. And that's it for the super chats. So just before we get out of here, I'll remind people I'm gonna have to go and lie down. I'm meant to be doing a cigar stream again tonight as well. I'm gonna have to go and like put my head in a vice and maybe eat something and take more pills and see if I can make another show. But do buy my courses. Foundations of Writing is the one that everybody needs, although there was a guy, every once in a while, a guy who really fancies it, gets into it. And he was on today, he was arguing that the right in right honourable is actually an adverb, like in right honourable gentleman. And I just assumed it was an adjective, right and, you know, right and honourable gentleman. Mm. And you just don't say the and. Well, he has got some, there are some sources that claim it's an adverb. And it has now brought up a question because the etymology of right honourable does seem quite obscure. And I've seen, I mean, there are whole book titles called Right and Honourable, where they actually insert the and, suggesting it's an adjective. But the OED claims it's an adverb, although it doesn't kind of show its workings.
I was going to say, I could pull out the OED, which is right over here.
Well, the OED says it's an adverb, but it doesn't give the etymology or explain why it thinks that. So it's interesting, though, one of those little interesting things, although, you know, strictly speaking, grammatically, you'd think, well, it's modifying the noun, so it should be a adjective, you'd think, but apparently there's precedent for saying it's an adverb, so there you go. Grammar.
I have a very broad relationship with adverbs, so.
Oh, I hate adverbs as well. I try to delete them all. Whenever I see them, I try to, like a kind of, they're like flies. You treat adverbs like kind of flies that need swatting or something like that, but I don't know. What do you think of adverbs?
As a writer, write some short fiction and poetry. I would, and whenever I wrote my criticism, I always try and avoid the adverb. The adverb is the enemy of the writer. If you're using an adverb, then you're basically trying to stress something that you should have been able to convey more directly. So it's a lapse.
The sentence always sounds stronger without the adverb as well.
Yeah.
Weirdly. Because it's more blunt in a way. Yeah. But let's not get to Ezra Pound.
Hemingway knew.
This is very Ezra Pound doing this Hemingway. But Foundations of Writing is pretty Pound-Hemingway school. Or George Orwell school, rather than Will Self or something, you know. anything you'd like to promote, Alexander Adams?
I'll just add a new one. If you want to test my poetry and see what my writing skills are like, then you can buy some books from Bournebrook Press. The link is in the Linktree page.
Andy?
Nothing to declare, Your Honour. Tune into Unpopular Opinions, I suppose, if that goes ahead.
I'll be back with Cigar Stream tonight and then probably... The one thing I haven't tried, Dee, is actually smoking a cigar. Some people did claim that it may be, in some strange way, like nicotine withdrawal.
I was going to say, it could be. I mean, so what I've used for years is a small intake of caffeine and aspirin. Not Nurofen, not, you know, paracetamol, but the actual acetylsalicylic acid, which apparently has some... fairly good reputation. So, and in fact, if you can get the sort that are kind of tablets that you put in water that are fizzy, they call them. I don't know. They're not Eno. Anyway.
I also have to figure out what Cigar Stream is going to be about because last night this dude was like, debate me, bro, debate me, bro. And then today I was like, yeah, you're all good then? And now he's like backing out. I'm going to do some. What I've got. I mean, there's a number of things I can do, but probably the most interesting thing is that I collected loads of data on US box office receipts, TV viewership, and so on. And I'm going to try to do a live estimation of how many people are actually consuming regime product, which is an interesting question. And it's got me into all sorts of interesting rabbit holes. For example, Netflix claim that 140 million people watch Stranger Things 4, but they've only got 75 million subs. So I'm calling BS. And I looked into it, and it turns out the Nielsen ratings have also called BS on that and reckon that only about 12 million people watch Stranger Things per episode. So there's all sorts of interesting little things. But basically, as far as I can work out, regime propaganda is reaching fewer eyeballs now than at pretty much any time in our recent history. So I might do a stream on that. I thought it might be quite interesting to look at. So, all right. See you all there for that. Thank you so much for the Francis Bacon stuff. And I'll see you later on.
What goes on in this town is none of your business.
As long as I'm living here, it is.
Then maybe you shouldn't be living here!
Well, that's easily fixed.